Now, I've been going around for many years doing books that I've written, and I found when I started on this book tour, which is this is what it is, part of a book tour, that I couldn't do it, that it was the subject was different from any other subject that I'd been writing about, and I was choked or blocked or tongue-tied or unable to. Somehow war is something you can't talk about. It seizes you. And it's far bigger than it's not a subject. It's not a topic. And we're all in some way suffering from that at the moment. We are actually all at war. And so what we do this evening is limited by our inability to cope with something much, much larger than we can really grasp. And that is the basic problem of reading, writing, thinking about war. And it perhaps the opening of this of my book may make some of that clearer. One sentence in one film, Patton, sums up what the book tries to understand. The general walks the field after battle, and you may remember this. Churned earth, burnt tanks, dead men. He takes up a dying officer, kisses him, surveys the havoc, and says, "I love it. God help me, I do love it so. I love it more than my life." We can never prevent war or speak sensibly of peace and disarmament unless we enter this love of war. Unless we move our imaginations into the martial state of soul, we cannot comprehend its pull. This means going to war. And this book aims to induct our minds into military service. We are not going to war in the name of peace, as deceitful rhetoric so often declares, but rather for war's own sake, to understand the madness of its love. Our civilian disdain and pacifist horror, all the legitimate and deep-felt aversion to everything to do with the military and the warrior, must be set aside. This because the first principle of psychological method holds that any phenomenon to be understood must be sympathetically imagined. No syndrome can be truly dislodged from its cursed condition unless we first move imagination into its heart. Now, in a passage written by Susan Sontag in an article, I think it was in The New Yorker, she says, speaking of war, "We truly can't imagine what it was like. We can't imagine how dreadful, how terrifying war is, and how normal it becomes. Can't understand. Can't imagine." Now, can't understand, can't imagine is unacceptable. It is unacceptable to think that we can't imagine or can't understand, because if we do that, we've abandoned the task of psychological thinking. We've abandoned the task of imagining. It gets us off the hook. Admitting defeat before we have even begun. Robert J. Lifton has said the task in our times is to imagine the real. If this war that we're now engaged in, and I say we because we are all engaged in it, we've all been drafted into it, had been thoroughly imagined before, it might never have happened. Lifton has said the task in our times is to imagine the real. Robert McNamara, Secretary of Defense during much of the Vietnam War, looking back, writes, "We can now understand these catastrophes for what they were, essentially the products of a failure of imagination." Donald Rumsfeld, when comparing the surprise at Pearl Harbor, in another place he says the failure of imagination. When comparing the surprise at Pearl Harbor with that of the Twin Towers, the director of the National Security Agency, Michael Hayden, said, "Perhaps it was more a failure of imagination this time than last." So the task gets clearer. The task is how to imagine the fullness of war before war has to happen. And that's what the book tries to do. And in that sense, the book is a kind of shock therapy, because it reports fully on the horror, the terrible aspect of war, as well as other parts. Now, I actually began thinking about this in 1980. There was a conference in Rhode Island Newport, and the Naval War College was present, and some of the good minds of the time were there. Denise Levertov, the poet, and Norman O'Brown, and others. And I gave a paper on the god Mars and war. And I've been thinking about it for many years, 20 years or more, long before even that. And then I began walking the battlefields of the Civil War in the 90s, place after place, three or four visits to different ones, and then another year going to another battlefields and other battlefields, to feel the presence of war. And the part of it goes back to my time in Philadelphia when I was at the Naval Hospital during the Second World War as a corpsman with the war wounded, that is, the Marines who came back from the Pacific War. So it isn't that I wrote this book in a hurry in connection with what's going on now. It's something that's been going on in my whole life. Now, one of the difficulties with not being able to imagine the war is set up in the first two parts of the book. There are four chapters only. And the first chapter is called War is Normal. And by that I mean that war has statistically, there have been more wars than there have been years of history. The recorded years of history show at least three wars per year since the beginning of recorded history. All of us in this room have not had a single year where there hasn't been a war going on somewhere. It is a completely normal phenomenon in life, whether we like it or not, and whether we believe peace is what's normal. Peace is defined in the dictionary as the absence of war. In other words, the definition of peace in the dictionary is a negative definition. No, there's no positive content. It's simply the calmness in the absence of war. War is the condition on which peace is based, by definition. So it's the more important thing. And this is what Heraclitus said at the beginning of Western thinking, 600 BC, war is the father of all things. It's what Kant said, that war is the normal condition of nations. It's what Hobbes said. It's what modern French philosopher Levinas said. War is the revelation of being. Being reveals itself as war. So undertaking anything to do with war as the deepest part of the cosmos, of the way things are, it seems to me something philosophers and maybe psychologists have avoided far too long. And we get drawn into it and submit to it and get killed by it without really spending enough time of reflection about it. A crucial aspect, and now I'd like to read another little piece from the book. One of the essential characteristic of war is its uncontrollable autonomy, and this has been noted by many writers, that wars come, as Eisenhower said, go on, have no limits. The force of war has no limits. Wars break out, their dogs unleashed, the soldiers rampage, firestorms engulf cities. The fantasy of war spreads across continents, into Star Wars, cyberspace. The horizon recedes into the next field of operations. Napoleon onto Moscow, Alexander across the Indus. A new crusade follows upon the last. MacArthur across the Yalu, Iraq after Afghanistan. Since war's autonomy generates its own momentum, war has no cause other than itself. Is war something, says Barbara Ehrenreich, is war something which really does have a life of its own? War's inhumanity tells war's truth. Its origins lie outside the human sphere, beyond human control. We have been misled, she argues, pinning war onto persons, politics, economics, gender. Go on with her quote. It is the autonomy of war as an institution that we have to confront and explain. Her explanation is remarkably imaginative. She conceives war on the model of a living organism, a self-replicating pattern of behavior possessed of a dynamism not unlike that of living things. Suddenly, war emerges as a fictive figure, a robotic golem, a brutal giant stalking his human prey, as an ancient poet wrote. In other words, as a god of itself that wants only to keep itself alive by feeding on its human victims. So war then begins to move in our minds towards something mythical, not an instinct in human beings to kill each other, because the instinct in human beings to kill each other can happen in a bar, can happen in a family feud, can happen every day in the newspaper, but that's not war. War is something that takes possession of a whole group, of a society, of a clan, of a tribe, of a people, of a nation, and makes them as mad as the god himself. Another little piece from the book about the autonomy. To go berserk means literally to wear the bear coat, from the Norse where ber means both bear and bear as naked, stripped to one's basic mammalian shape. I became a fucking animal, reports a veteran to Jonathan Shea. Only a shell remains of the human person who consists of memories, feelings, words, needs for food and shelter. One participant in the Somme slaughter in 1916, in which 60,000 people, 60,000 British casualties in one day, writes that it was so impersonal that one cannot feel any personal emotion. Hope, revenge, anger, contempt, any of these would be a sustaining emotion in action, but very few experience them. The Norse sagas named this death trance condition Fey, F-E-Y, meaning doomed. One writer reporting on battle describes it as an eerie mood that would come over people in battle, a kind of transcendent despair. They feel something in their soul surrender, and they give in to everything they've been most afraid of. It's like a glimpse of eternity. The notorious German writer and militarist intellectual Ernst Jünger describes in his diary the state of the soul as the last push of the German army in 1918 rises out of the trenches toward the enemy lines. Quote, I was boiling with a mad rage, which had taken hold of me and all others in an incomprehensible fashion. Taken hold of him. In an incomprehensible fashion. The overwhelming wish to kill gave wings to my feet. The monstrous desire for annihilation, which hovered over the battlefield, thickened the brains of the men in a red fog. We called each other in sobs and stammered disconnected sentences. A neutral observer might perhaps have believed we were seized by an excess of happiness. At Antietam, in the ferocious fight in the cornfield, some even noticed a queer phenomenon. Fearful at first of going into battle, some men found that when it began, they lost their terror and instead were seized by a peculiar fearlessness and compulsion heralded by everything in sight taking on a crimson hue. Literally, they saw red. These are the actual reports of what people saw and felt. Seized by a red fog, lost in a red fog. At a certain moment, again back to the Civil War, at the Battle of Missionary Ridge, as the Yankee troops climbed up the mountainside into well-prepared and well-defended positions of the rebels, who held the heights with some 10,000 men, the Yanks had more than twice that number, but the terrain was steep, if any of you have been there in Tennessee, and the soldiers burdened. Each carried a 9-pound rifle and around 80 rounds of ammunition, plus, this was November, in the mountains, a heavy winter overcoat. And then this is the report of these men climbing Missionary Ridge. First one, then another, began going up the slope toward the enemy. It was mostly spontaneous. No arm dropped to start the troops forward, no command had been shouted, and no bugle blew. There went a squad suddenly, then another, followed by a platoon here and a company there. Junior officers yelled for these men to stop, but they soon caught the fever and joined the rush. It was now an army of inspiration, not deliberation, caught in a dangerous mood of directionless adventure. Down below at Orchard Knob, Grant foresaw the makings of a gigantic disaster. Sherman on his left had been trying all day to go up Missionary Ridge, but had been foiled and humiliated. The Blue Army was trying to scale a wall in the face of overwhelming firepower. Grant could see it. "Thomas, who ordered those men up the ridge?" Thomas said, "I don't know, I did not." "Did you order them up, Granger?" asked Grant. "No, they started up without orders." Grant began muttering, dissatisfied. Several general officers were not as cautious as Grant. They also sensed something infectious in the air, some mood. I read those passages in order to give the feeling of the experience of being driven, possessed, carried by something more than human. And it's part of the second chapter in the book called War is Inhuman. Now, it's very hard to hold in your mind this idea that something is both normal, war is normal, and yet inhuman. It's a terrible paradox, because we would like if what's human to be normal, not what's inhuman to be normal, and so on and so forth. Now, when you get a dilemma of that sort, and this applies to us as citizens, it has been shown by Milton Erickson and other psychologists that one of the ways to induce hypnotic trance, that is, to put people to sleep, is to give them an impossible paradox. You can't hold it in your mind, and so denial sets in and you go to sleep. You block it out. You blank it out. It's too much to hold. It's too difficult to hold. So we search desperately for some rational reason for war. It must be oil. It must be economics. It must, you know, some kind of way to hold it all together. But the strange thing is that psychologically, when Susan Sontag says we can't imagine and can't understand, it's part of the condition of being asleep. And that's why waking up through holding on to the paradox is so crucially important. Not solving the problem of war by an easy solution or an idea of peace, a cheap idea of peace. Now I want to shift to another part of the book, which is the third chapter, called War is Sublime. The desperate American retreat from the Yalu River after the failed invasion of North Korea had to pass into a tight, ice-cold ravine under enemy fire through which funnel the only escape route lay. From end to end, this sanctuary was already filled with bodies, the living and the dead. Wounded men could no longer move, the exhausted and able body driven to earth by fire. It was a sump pit of all who had become detached from their vehicles and abandoned to each other. 200 men in the ditch so that their bodies overlapped. Americans, Turks, ROKs. Yet there was cooperative motion and human response. Men who were still partly mobile crawled forward along the chain of bodies. As they moved, those who were down and hurt cried, "Water, water." Long since, nearly all canteens were dry, but the able-bodied checked long enough to do what bandaging they could. Some stripped to the waist in the bitter cold and tore up their undershirts for dressings. Others stopped their crawl long enough to give their last drop of water. The wounded who were bound to the ditch tried to assist the able-bodied seeking to get out. Witnesses saw more of the decency of men than had ever been expected. There is tenderness. One man diverts another from self-centered preoccupation. A man helps another man to die, talking him into letting go. Another assuages guilt for a costly fuck-up. Medicine of the heart given in thoughtful doses. Men in small units care for each other, cover for each other. A French soldier spoke of feeling in the trenches the most tender human experience that he had ever enjoyed. Men who had been only lightly wounded or briefly relieved sometimes sneaked back to their units, called by solidarity with their buddies, or called by the impossible possibility of dying together. To be close to death is close to immortality. Gray, who wrote a great deal of a very splendid book on war, calls it communal ecstasy. There is an unquenchable desire to help. These are the kinds of love that go on in the middle of the horror. A veteran of Vietnam, 20 years after the ugly wounding and dying of men around him, says, "There was nothing I could do to help. Sometimes my thoughts take me right back to what happened to the guys there. I wish I could have helped them." There's the terrible love that breaks out in mourning, a sobbing passion for a mate suddenly taken. Already in Homer, the term himeros, appearing in an aphroditic context, means both the desire to weep and the sweet desire of sexual urgency. Grieving in war is one of the ways the love goddess works in the soul. There is bravery for the sake of another, to take the point, to volunteer, to just go on so as not to let your bunch down. "Men are not brave by nature," said Field Marshal Haig. Somehow, love makes them brave. There is simply love for war itself. One man who received 3 Purple Hearts and survived 175 battle patrols in Korea volunteered for more again and again. "I had the feeling I had missed the complete experience. The possibility of triumphant being over death or in death offered by union with the God." Martha Bales calls this dimension the war sublime. There is love for a leader. A sergeant in hospital at the end of World War II wrote a letter to his former company commander, "Dick, you are loved and will never be forgotten by any soldier that ever served under you. You are the best friend I ever had, and I only wish we could have been on a different basis. You were my ideal and motor in combat. I would follow you into hell." There is psychological insight. A 19-year-old corporal explains how men help those on the edge of collapse. "You can see it coming on, and sometimes the other guys can help out." "How do you mean you can see it coming on?" "Well, first they get trigger happy. They go running all over the place looking for something to shoot at. Then the next thing you know, they got the battle judders. They jump if you light a match and go diving for cover if someone bounces a tin hat off a rock. You can just about see them let out a mental scream to themselves. How can the other fellows help out?" The corporal looked down at his hands a little sheepishly. You can kind of cover up for a guy like that before he's completely gone. He can be sent back to get ammo or something, you know, and he knows he's going to stay out of sight for a while, but you don't let on, see? Then he can pretend to himself he's got a reason for being back there, and he still has his pride. This from a 19-year-old boy. Psychology. Instant psychology. Real psychology. So, for more on this kind of therapeutic love, if you will, you might read Philip Roth's The Human Stain. More than tea and sympathy, This is T, an active, intelligent, respectful, insightful, courageous, committed, decent, imaginative, particularized, patient, sensitive, responsive love. Real love, true love, long-lasting love that meets madness and death and does not retreat from the memory of ghouls or harpies descending, and it begins in war and does not end when war ends. Some observers suggest that the intensity of war's love arises from the collapse of all others. All the former attachments in the roles of husband, father, son, even sweetheart, faded and forsaken. The evidence for female military personnel is less plentiful, less sifted, and abstracted into conclusions. These faded loves flare for a moment in a letter or a dream, but they no longer have palpable power, whereas buddy, comrade, mate, and the endearment expressed in nicknames of the guys in the platoon, the shared bitter amusement and cosmic griping, compresses all human love into those few with whom I watch on guard, skirmish, cower, as well as eat, piss, and sleep. Talk has little to do with it. Idiosyncrasies do. The peculiar mumbo-jumbo that bans fright, the odd way a person holds a mug or worries about his feet, the bandana, the cigarette, or joint. These are intimacies that foster the annoying lovableness that makes for comradeship. Talk? What is there to talk about? Home? What is that? Who was that? Me? Psychotherapy may know what talk can do for love and how right Freud was to call his medicine the talking cure. Psychotherapy may not know that love does not need talk. The less said, the better. The rhythm of a small group moving forward in stealth all day, all night, covering for one another, the shared physical imagination of danger, exhaustion, boredom, obliteration, and the strung-out nerves yield an unspeaking and unspeakable kind of love between men pulling the same load, caught in the same despair. Love in war exposes one of our fondest false notions. We like to believe that death is private and solitary. Each departs alone. We believe we are owners of our own death, the possession of which we confirm by wills, with binding instructions that include the disposal of our remains. Is this idea of death not corollary to the bourgeois sanctity of private property? The mental set that constructs the isolation of our dying is the same bourgeois mentality that builds our individual living spaces with doors of separation to guarantee privacy and single beds in which to die alone. So conceived, death is a lonely thing, all your own, and this conception finds its intellectual reinforcement in the existential philosophy of Heidegger and Kierkegaard and Sartre. We do not bury men as they lived and died in solidarity, but each apart in his own marked and numbered grave, rows and rows of them like suburban plots in meticulously bordered war cemeteries. This, despite the witness of comrades who may visualize death as a companionable experience, says another major writer on war, reporting on a paratrooper who said, "If it were my destiny to die in battle, it would come by TL's side, surrounded by Berkeley, the Arab, Duquesne, Casey, Gruning, and the other stalwarts of the platoon." The bullet may have found only one man in the platoon. He may have been singled out by a sniper, but neither his death nor his body belong to that one man alone. Buddies go to extremes to bring a body back from where it fell, not letting it lie alone, denying the singleness of death by their communal enterprise. There is community in dying, and if your death belongs to others, we are essentially not alone. That is one of the great teachings of war. Now, We need to think now, since we're so engaged, in the possibilities of what can be done about it, since it's an autonomous possession, since it captures us and has a madness in it. What is the protection against the madness? And the book suggests, before we get to the last chapter, which is, as I say, the first is war is normal, the second is war is inhuman, and the third is war is sublime, and the fourth, rather than war is religion, is called religion is war. So we'll come to that. But before there, I want to say something about what happened in I want to talk about the possibility of taming war. One thing is that's possible is slowing the madness of the rush through resistance, reflection, deliberation, which was what the Senate was originally intended to do, was to deliberate in leisure, if not in leisure, but at least deliberate the possibilities of going to war in our system of government. I want to talk about the aesthetic possibility of restraint on war, the possibility of aesthetic restraint. As a manner of taming the madness of the god, with highly fashioned, ritualized, overindulged aesthetics. From the first salute in boot camp to the last decoration, a love for aesthetics is on parade. Little patches of color and braid and lace distinguished regiments in almost all armies. The Austrians meticulously differentiated between 10 shades of red in their uniforms, including madder, cherry, rose, amaranth, carmine, lobster, scarlet, and wine. Standing on the civilian sidewalk, military rites and rhetoric seem high pomposity and kitsch. Even though we feel stirred by marching band, the banners, and the rhythm of the feet, aesthetic details unabashed and everywhere, the postures, the spit and polish, the chicken shit regulations, and stylized speech. Why do they drill? Why do they march? Why do they forever clean latrines, shine banisters, oil parts, polish floors, precisely fold their gear, pack their sea bags, trim their hair? Spahis in streaming scarlet cloaks, Bengal lancers in turbans of peacock hue, this was in the last century, of course, Madrasis in French gray and silver, Skinner's irregulars in canary yellow. Imagine, too, the horses, their manes and tails, the accoutrements, the brasses, remember the swagger stick, the ivory-handled pistols, epaulettes, decorated sleeves, bamboo baton, the bugles, the drums, the dances of warriors, the marching songs, the choruses, the special clothes, Wellington boots, Eisenhower jacket, Sam Brown belts. Tomorrow I shall have my new battle jacket. If I'm to fight, I like to be well-dressed, said Patton. It's curious that in later wars, such as the war at the moment, there is a kind of casual, ordinary, indistinct uniforms, camouflage, and hard to tell the officer from an enlisted man, ranks and all those things are somehow, the hierarchy, the aesthetic hierarchy is marked down. So one has to think, what was all that for? Had that formalism something to do with keeping a check, keeping a discipline, keeping a form on the madness? Is this aesthetic excess merely to embellish war by dressing it up or to mask its ugliness? Or could it be, however, serve a better purpose? These forms and formalities might be following a profound function. They place the mad dog in an aphroditic halter. There may not be a moral, as William James sought, but an aesthetic equivalent of war. Not a moral equivalent of war, which you may all know that phrase from William James, in which he said the problem is to find some moral purpose that could muster and unify the people equal to war, a moral equivalent of war. And I'm suggesting there might be an aesthetic equivalent of war. And I'll read you a short piece about that. Check the, our time. How are we? All right? We're all right. Prior to 19th century and industrialism, war was subject to cultural restraints. The previous century's religious wars between Protestant and Catholic armies that tore the continent of Europe apart and the horrific brutalities of colonialism somehow subsided in the Age of Enlightenment. Now remember, our country was founded in the Age of Enlightenment. When we talk about the founding fathers and so on and so forth, they were secularists, free thinkers, as they were called at that time, of the products of the Age of Enlightenment. The 18th century, now I'm reading from a book, not reading from him, but using a couple of history books, one by a man named Neff, N-E-F. The 18th century in Europe showed a distaste for bloodshed, a decrease in the mistreatment of captured prisoners, and a reluctance to kill fellow Europeans. The period was marked by the influence of the royal and princely courts upon decorum and manners, of the salons on conversation and the expression of emotion, of cities on a differentiated elaboration of the senses, and by free-thinking philosophers less gripped by religion. And thereby weakening the will, is his quotation, weakening the will of organized fighting and questioning its purpose. Europeans were falling in love with the perfections of the mind, and in proportion to the number of people alive, especially to the number of people with political influence, a much larger audience for serious thought and art than in our day. Serious thinking was carried on by Thomas Paine, Voltaire, Leibniz, Hume, Diderot, Swift, Samuel Johnson, among scores of others who were critical, skeptical, radical, political, advancing a kind of intellectual guerrilla warfare against the cant and hypocrisy that form the fabric of nationalist patriotism, sentimental personalism, and the lightheaded religiosity so signal in our times. Diderot, who believed in the absolute authority of the people and is the spiritual father of American democracy and of Jefferson and Madison and so, said on his deathbed, Diderot, "I do not believe in God the Father, God the Son, or God the Holy Ghost." And that took a lot of courage in a Catholic country to say that on his deathbed. These many men and the many women with whom they conversed, corresponded, and slept were not institutionalized academics, but intellectually alive citizens forming the minds and tastes of the courts and the expanding middle class. This same period did see increases in the standing armies, yet the poetic virtues were more respected than the military virtues. It was an age, says Neff, when contemporary art was a part of contemporary history. There are numbers to support this demilitarization. The proportion of combatants to the total population dropped from 500 in the 17th century to 380 in the 18th. You follow me here. More people were alive in Europe, but fewer were engaged in European wars. The proportion of those engaged in fighting dropped, although the population increased. It goes without saying that European bellicosity did not disappear. It was exported in exploitations abroad, naval rivalries, and slave trading. There were still pirates to conquer and duels to fight, though here too Louis XIV prescribed the death penalty for all principals, seconds and thirds, in an attempt to end the hugely popular practice. The Sun King himself refused to have the French armies adopt a newly invented gunpowder with more murderous properties on the ground that it was too destructive of human life. Have we yet not used one of our cluster bombs or whatever stuff that we're using landmines on because it could be too destructive of human life? Late in his life, the Sun King said, "I have been too fond of war." And that is a possibility that we need to pass through our minds, the possibility that would a culture such, a civilization, let's not call it a culture, a civilization such as ours, at this moment in its history, when there isn't a great deal of interest on the part of the powers that be in the arts, in wit, in metaphor, in conversation, in all those things of the 18th century, the decline, on the one hand, of the arts and the rise of militarism, is there a correlation, as a reverse correlation to what was in the 18th century? And could the bullying, which occupies everyone engaged in education in the school systems today, the problem of bullying and the decline of the arts in the same schools, have anything to do with each other? Because the bullying is one of the causes of childhood suicide and one of the reasons for it, the increase of childhood suicide, and is one of the most worrisome issues facing not just teachers, but mothers. And where have all the arts gone in the schools at the same time? So that's what I'm talking about when I say an aesthetic, a possibility of an aesthetic taming of war, an aesthetic taming, not only the one of slowing things down in the beginning, because once it starts, it's almost impossible to stop. But could it be also slowed down through an increase of aesthetic culture? So I open that for you all to give some thought to. Maybe we can talk about. Now I'll read another little bit. Well, I think maybe we've had enough, no? Shall I read? Let's see, just one more little thing here. Why I say religion is war. A quotation from Walter Lippmann. Some of you may remember Walter Lippmann, who used to write columns in the newspaper many years ago. The existence of many churches in one community weakens the foundation of them all. And the point here is that a monotheistic psychology must be dedicated to unity, and its psychopathology is intolerance of difference. Hence, the issue of toleration has plagued theological thinkers for ages, leading to schisms and more schisms. As long as you hold that your God is the perfect supreme deity, all other gods will be lesser. There are no several truths, no other roads to the kingdom, and the Roman Catholic Church has not renounced its claim to exclusivity, officially still asserting to be, quote, the one and only Church of God. It is through Christ's Catholic Church alone, which is the all-embracing means of salvation. And this, so when war clouds gather, religious belief electrifies the air. When our belief is in the Republic and the Republic is declared endangered, we rally around the flag for which it stands. Whatever the object of belief, the flag, the nation, the president, or the god, a martial energy mobilizes. Decisions are quick, dissent more difficult, doubt which impedes action and questions certitude becomes traitorous, an enemy to be silenced. The single focus on one true God requires the belief be cohesive and organized. The psychology of Christian monotheism, for instance, strives to maintain a defined coherence of its object, God, and a cohesion of belief among believers. There is, quote, there is one body and one spirit, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Ephesians 4:4-6. Already in 325, the Council of Nicaea, that's only about 14 years after Constantine's conversion, so immediately came the question of trying to unify the Christian belief. Leading Christians from diverse places and professions of faith to formulate one agreed definition of Christian belief as a credo, and we still call religions creeds. Yet, ever since, the text of that creed, as well as the words of the scriptures, have been battled over, slaughtering sister and brother Christians, believers, through the ages in attempts to determine the final authorized version of what is correct to believe. And here I want to make a distinction that I think is important. The psychology of Jewish monotheism, and I'm not talking here about Islamic, but of Jewish monotheism, differs radically from Christian, putting the lie to that hyphen which attempts to fuse the two into the so-called Judeo-Christian religion. The raging intolerance of the biblical God of the Jews was mollified through hundreds of years and hundreds of thousands of pages of interpretations and commentaries, leavening the literalism with metaphorical, mystical, and many-leveled meanings. Biblical Hebrew consists in clusters of consonants without completely clear vowels, so that a text may and does support widely different connotations, favoring uncertainty and rich obscurity. Punctuation is also seriously missing. All this together allows an amazing freedom of hermeneutic fantasy and almost comical hair-splitting. Literalist singleness of meaning becomes but only one fantasy among others. But the warlike spirit of ancient Judaism, until the literalist revival focused in Orthodox Israel, dissipated in the diaspora of the Jewish people and fragmented under scholarly dispute. That spirit, however, that warlike spirit, found another home when the Bible was transported into Christianity as its Old Testament. The bellicosity of the prophets and judges and kings became part of the new religion, and also of the new religion of Islam, which also incorporated biblical figures and motives into the Quran. Chapter 61, Battle Array, for example. The appropriations of the Jewish Bible, unmitigated by later centuries of differing rabbinical opinions, options, favored a more militant literalism in the new reading. In contrast to that Christian literalism, a 1990 survey in the United States found that only 14.2% of those declaring themselves Jews consider the Bible to be the actual Word of God, whereas 90% of American Christians believe, for instance, in the virgin birth of Jesus. And there are other figures of that sort. I'm picking on this particular problem of American Christianity because America has the most devoutly Christian numbers of believers, literal believers, and also has the most powerful military force. So there's where there's a huge problem. I think I'll stop with that heavy thought.